My name is Florencia Lozano. I'm an actress. You might have seen me on One Life to Live, Narcos, Gossip Girl, and I recently co-wrote a screenplay called Life After You. You are watching FaceTime with Todd Wharton, the one and only.
Hey guys, so those that know me know that growing up, I was a huge hip-hop fan, and one of my favorite groups was Digital Underground. Though I never met the group, they had a huge impact on my life, so I wanted to do something for them. And Shock G, this is for you, bro. Rest in peace.
Oh, I'll drink a ball of Hennessy you got on your shelf.
Oh no, honey. I know you ain't drinking Grandma's juice.
I like the girls with the broom. I once got busy in a Burger King bathroom.
What? There was no seating in the dining area, and I like a romantic setting.
Oh yes, ladies, I'm really being sincere, because in the 69 my Humpty nose will tickle your rear.
Why does everybody think this is sexual? I'm a mechanic. Man, you guys are sick.
Let me tell you a little bit about this dance. It's real easy to do. Check it out. First I limped to the side like my legs was broken.
I'm laying down.
Shout out to the whole world. Keep on doing the Humpty dance. And to all the ladies, peace and humptiness forever.
Coming up next, actress Florencia Lozano. So welcome back to the show, everyone. So my guest tonight is an award-winning actress. You've seen her on a daytime soap, One Life to Live. You've seen her in Narcos on Netflix, in Bull, in Gossip Girl, and so much more. But right now, she's starring in a new independent film, Life After You. But you know what? Let's take a look at a clip.
Hi, I'm Florencia Lozano, Taya Delgado from One Life to Live, here to give you a sneak peek at what's happening on your favorite ABC daytime soap.
I have a lot of nice things to say about romance. Just not romance and me. Although I did receive a marriage proposal recently.
It's a joke, right?
Wrong.
Come on. Taya Delgado doesn't marry for love or money.
Well, you're half right.
Blair, if you're gonna wear one of my designs, tell me so we can at least get it properly fitted.
Thanks, Mom. Keep that in mind. Great party.
She is my best advertisement.
There was no way Pablo Escobar was getting out of this one. Right?
Pablo Escobar.
Pablo Escobar.
Pablo Escobar has escaped from prison.
Hangman is coming down from the gallows and I don't have very long.
How could you not tell me Doug was using... How could you not know Danny was? This isn't your fault.
Yes, it is.
We couldn't have gone on without you. I couldn't have gone on without you.
Please welcome to the show, Florencia Lozano.
I'm great. I'm great. I'm really honored to be interviewed by you, Todd. Thank you.
Thank you for saying that. I'm honored to have you. And I got to tell you something, man. I'm really feeling your vibe right now. You lay back and chill. And it's such a pleasure because I'm kind of laid back and chill, especially when I'm not doing, opioids or morphine like you are in your character. That just passed away in the movie, but we'll get to that. But I'm just playing everybody. I don't do anything like that. I'm just naturally. But first of all, congrats on a career well done so far. And I'm saying so far because you were obviously halfway through. I mean, anywhere from One Life to Live, The Gossip Girl. I caught you on Bull. Bull's actually one of my favorite shows, which is pretty cool. And now... besides doing Narcos, which is an incredible series on Netflix, you actually got to do a screenplay that you wrote with Sarah called Life After You. And this is an incredible movie. I caught a lot of clips of it that your publicist sent me. But I have to ask, how did you decide to write a screenplay based on a situation that's occurring more and more in our lives when it comes to the war on drugs, with people dying every day from overdose? And tell me about that.
So someone brought me an offer. Charlene Giannetti, who was one of the producers on Life After You, along with Sarah, who you mentioned, I co-wrote the screenplay with, And she also, Sarah directed the movie and is a producer on it as well. Charlene had interviewed Linda Latterman, whose son Danny died in 2014 at 19 years old in his bedroom of a heroin overdose that had been laced with fentanyl.
Wow.
And Charlene was, I did not know this woman, and she called me out of the blue. She knew my work from acting. She knew my acting work. And she said, I want you to play Linda Latterman in a movie I am going to write about, based, inspired by a book that that Linda Latterman wrote. I just interviewed her, and this story needs to be a film so that more people can hear it.
Right.
And she was so passionate about that. She was so almost like on fire about it that I was really moved. And I felt like, well, there's just no saying no to this woman. I was like, yes, I will absolutely play Linda Latterman. And I'll tell you, all along the process, all during the process, I had severe doubts that I could even do that.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, this was a giant leap of faith on all of our parts. I had never written a screenplay, neither had Sarah. We had never co-written something together. She had never directed a full length. And Charlene had never produced a movie. So what kept us going was the importance of the story. And, you know, Linda, after I met her, because I did meet her as I signed on to do this project, I was really taken by how she talked about, after her son died, she continued to talk to her son in an effort to understand how this could have happened. She was so completely blindsided, as was her whole family. She says now, you know, she would have put her hand in fire to swear that her son would never do such a thing as take heroin. So when she talked about driving around in her car and talking to her son, and that made me think, Charlene, let me try my hand at writing the screenplay with Sarah, because I wanted to write the story from a slightly more with one foot in sort of an emotional reality of a mother refusing to accept that her son was gone.
Right.
Because for a long time, that was a part of Linda's grieving process, was this shock, this total shock that she felt, I must be in some sort of a nightmare.
Yeah.
Because this couldn't possibly have happened to me. We were a close family. My son and I were best friends. I talked to him directly about drugs. And Charlene said, yes, you can write the screenplay. So that's how that happened.
Yeah. And kudos to you for even getting involved with this, because when I speak to a lot of actors, one of the things I always ask them is, did you ever have a personal experience? Because when you go after a role like this, it's very hard to adapt to it, especially when it's a serious reality role, right? And you're playing a mom where a kid overdosed. And one of the dilemmas parents have is, and you guys actually hit it in the movie, is where people are like, how did you not know? Well, I don't think people realize that when somebody's going through something horrible, whether it's suicide thoughts or drugs, or, you know, they're pregnant, as much as they want to talk to their parents because those are their guardian angels, they're also ashamed, right? So people create two different lives. So they have their lives outside of home, right? And then when they go home, they have the home life. And I think people forget that, because when me and you were kids, we were always good at home most of the time. But outside of home, we weren't the same. Like, we even talked trash about our parents when we're outside to be tougher with the other kids. And I think that was a dilemma. I love that you hit on that, because there's a scene where a lady was yelling and you went after her And then you got into his controversy in a supermarket, I believe. And it was a great scene. It was very emotional. But people really have to understand that kids don't tell their parents negative stuff that's going on because they feel ashamed, like they let down the parents, right? And I love you did that. But how hard was it for you to really, really take on a role that's emotionally damaging, even to you, if you have kids? Did you put yourself in that predicament where, what if that was me?
Well, you hit on a lot of things, and you said shame a couple times, and I think shame cannot be underestimated. I mean, I feel like if I had a wish for the whole world, it would be like for us to realize that we are all struggling with so much shame.
Mm-hmm.
And to be able to connect with each other is an opportunity to realize, you know, I am not alone in this shame. I too am human. I have made mistakes. I have made bad decisions. Like, part of being human is failing constantly.
Correct.
And I think the agreement that anyone makes when they become a parent is to fail. You know, you will fail your kids. That's why it's the most open-hearted, generous thing you can do, because it's such a humbling experience of saying, I'm going to fuck this up.
Yep.
There's nothing I can do. You know, that's just the deal.
Yeah.
And and that's an incredibly vulnerable place to be. You know, what we're trying to get across with this movie is like the landscape now on the street in terms of the drugs that are available is different than when you and I were kids.
Right.
Now there are drugs out there like fentanyl, carfentanil, that are mixed in to heroin, to cocaine. And those drugs will kill you if they are in too large an amount after one use.
Right.
So now you're really gambling with your life if you buy hard drugs on the street and experiment with them, which, you know, kids, that's what we did as kids. We not try hard drugs in my case, but we did things that we didn't want our parents to know about. That is part of being a kid. I get that. I honor that. And our movie really, you know, tries to ask the question, how do we get through the kids that it's a matter of life and death?
Yep.
That there are certain things that, you know, keep to yourselves, figure out for yourselves, but street drugs like heroin and coke, you have to ring the alarm bell. If you know of a friend who's doing that, if someone comes to you, please talk to a trusted adult. You know, your peers, that's kids usually go to their peers. I get it.
Mm-hmm.
They don't trust adults. And I get that too, but this is again a matter of life and death. And yep. And that's the conversation we're hoping to have with kids.
Yeah. And you know, I'm loving that you said that. I mean, I did my own research. Like, I was amazed when I saw in 2019, over 50,000 people died on average of overdose. And then we got COVID. And it's like, I don't understand what's going on in this world. We have enough to deal with AIDS, cancer, and all these other natural diseases or unnatural, you know, that people call them. Why are we like going out there to create other ways to kill ourselves? And originally fentanyl was created to help cure cancer, right? It was a cancer developed, but if you mix it in with any other drug, it's 80 to 100 times more lethal. And then people don't do drug users don't do research, right? They do it because they're depressed or somebody turned it on to them. Now, to go on just a positive note, you got to work with Gary Perez, which is a Harlem native. And a lot of people, if they don't know, Gary, you know, co-created the Labyrinth Theater Company with a gentleman who is an amazing Oscar nominee, actor, award winner, Philip Seymour Hoffman. And this is a great guy that you got to co-star with. And I think you both nailed these roles. How was it to work with him?
Oh my God. Well, Gary and I have been friends for a long time. I am a member of Labyrinth, and you know, it's funny, in some ways it kind of connects to the theme of the movie, because one thing I learned during the writing of this play was, and when we shot it too, was the opposite of addiction is connection. You know, the opposite of isolation is community. And Labyrinth, which the acronym stands for Latino Actors Base,
right,
was really an effort to empower and create a network of actors. Most of us, you know, actors of color, children of immigrants, people from different countries, with our roots in a sort of cultural connection, all being Latinos. Not, and I should say, even from the very start, Latin Actors Base or Labyrinth had Jews. We had Black people. It wasn't just Latinos, but we were formed to really tell our stories and to be in control of our narrative, as opposed to being labeled or being pigeonholed. We wanted the freedom to create the work we wanted to create and to invite the audiences in that we felt hadn't been considered when it came to most of the theatrical landscape in New York City. You know, let's have people in here who've never seen a play before, who don't think plays are about them. Let's tell their stories. Now, working with Gary, it was just so fortuitous, because he and I have very different styles of when we're on set. You know, Gary is just like, he's going to make everyone in the room feel comfortable, playful. He really approaches things from a very relaxed craft perspective. He really knows what he's doing on camera. I've actually taken classes with him, and he's an incredible teacher. Acting for camera classes. And for this role, I really, I went in, and oftentimes, you know, I didn't hang around on set. I had like a coat over my head, or because I was trying to access, as you said, you know, what would it feel like if basically the worst thing on earth happened to me? Because I can think of nothing worse than a parent losing a child. So we had a good dynamic. I think the crew really felt included by Gary. They loved having him there. He's a real joker. He loves to poke fun at people. He loves music. You know, he's just really fun to be around. And he was so present for me. So it was such a joy and such a comfort to be able to work with someone who I've known for so long.
And you guys were really great together. And I'm loving the positive reaction from a lot of people. I know you won a couple of Best Nods actress for this award, which is really, really cool. Congratulations on that. And I know a lot of festivals are really taking this home. And I'm loving more of these movies that are coming out, because I also just interviewed people from still working 9 to 5, the directors and producers, and a lot of people are really coming out with reality movies now, from women empowerment to drug use. And I think COVID's really putting that in perspective, that life is too short, right? Life is too precious. And a lot more movies like this need to come out, because people really only get to know reality from non-reality TV, right? And the reason why I'm saying non-reality is because TV is kind of like our fantasy land, right? And we learn more by watching. Everybody wants to be an Avenger, but nobody understands that when those Avengers say cut, they're humans just like me and you, right? And I love movies like this. Now, what's really cool is your film was picked up by Freestyle Digital Media, which is a subdivision of Byron Allen's group, which is pretty much, they acquired the North American rights for this thing. How honored were you to find out that they took over this thing and they were able to market this thing for you? That's great.
Well, one producer I have not told you about, his name is Brian Long. Sarah Schwab and Brian Long started Cardinal Flicks, and this was right. This Life After You is their first film, mm-hmm. and they're hitting it out of the park. Brian Long is our secret superhero, speaking of superheroes, mm-hmm. behind this film.
Nice.
He's the hardest working person I know, mm-hmm. and you know, he's a producer in the truest sense, that he loves to be behind the scenes. You know, mm-hmm. he never wants to get up during our talk back discussions. He never wants to the spotlight, but he worked so hard. I mean, you know, independent film, raising the money for it, making it happen. It is really challenging. Yep. And he made it happen. He really made it happen. And he was the one who got that distribution deal. And I remember when he called us and told us, God, he was so happy. He was yes. so happy. And the more I learned about Byron Allen and what it meant for us, basically that if you have a cable box in your home, you can rent or buy I was going to say One Life to Live, Life After You. And so tremendously, tremendously honored. And it's not just in North America, people in Argentina, where I have relatives, in Australia.
Right. In South That's America. Where your mom is from, correct? She's a Spanish teacher originally from Argentina. Is that correct?
No, both my mom and my dad are from Argentina.
Yeah. And your dad was an architect. So it's kind of funny when you're using theatrical landscape. Ironically, that was an architect, not for theater, but for the world. It's kind of cool.
Yeah. Yeah. My dad was an architect. My mom was a Spanish teacher. I mean, she still teaches. She literally teaches some of my friends Spanish. Like they have, you know, dates, and she's a teacher at heart. She just loves to teach. So, and they're both from Argentina. Yeah.
Beautiful. I love that. And, I wanted to go off on another note, a couple more questions for you. What I love, and when I was speaking with Patrika Darbo, and I wanted to ask you, I know when you become a soap star, a lot of times you get caught in a box where people prejudge a soap star for not being the greatest, but they don't understand that if you go by the hardest to the easiest in acting, soap is actually the hardest, because I don't think people understand that you get a Al Pacino monologue on a daily basis that you have to memorize within 24 hours. Like sometimes I don't remember what I want to eat when I go out to a restaurant, let alone. And what I'm loving about it is more and more soap actors are coming out of that box and doing other things, movies, you know, more TV roles. And they're realizing that, wow, soap actors are amazing. Yeah. Guys, you try to do a monologue that's 8 paragraphs long and memorize it. How was your transition from soap to the big screen for you?
Well, thanks for asking that question. Because, you know, it's funny. I was looking at one of the promo videos that you made where it was a tiny little clip of a scene where I was talking to Rachel at the time on One Life to Live.
Yeah.
Back in the day. And I thought to myself, we shot that in one day. Yep. There was a bunch of other scenes, hair, makeup, blocking. Like, I don't think people realize soaps shoot a show a day.
That's right.
So yes, there are times for sure that people put us in boxes. And it, for me, what that did is really built my muscle of like, you know, what other people think of me is really not my business.
Exactly.
I am going to continue to do the work that I love, that is meaningful to me. Mm-hmm. I'm going to show up and do the best job I can, which I got to tell you, on a soap, that's hard to do.
It's the hardest thing to do in acting, in my opinion.
Now, the upside, I'll tell you what the upside is, Todd. After doing a soap,
mm-hmm.
I feel like I can do anything. I go on Bull and people are like, oh shoot, we're doing 8 pages a day. And I was like, we got this, you know? By the way, Bull, the crew and the cast, was so fun to work on that show.
Yeah.
I loved that show. But yeah, episodic stuff, even, you know, this film, Life After You, which we shot in 28 days, and we did, you know, a couple pages a day. Yes, it was hard. Yes, it was relentless. Yes, but with the soap, you're doing it month after month after month. And you know, okay, you're not working every day,
right?
But there are weeks where you're working every day and you have lots of pages to learn every day.
That's
right. So it built muscles in me that I am so grateful for now.
Yeah, you could tell. I mean, you could tell when you hit the screen how good you are. And I was very impressed. And I love the diversity of roles that you play. You go from playing a woman who's pretty much all about, do I love this person or do I want them for their money or their power? And I'm going to be sarcastic at the same time. And I'm going to be like a little quirky woman. And then you're playing this role and then all the other roles you did. And I thought it was great. And guys, if you don't know, you guys can definitely check this movie out, Life After You, on pay-per-view and video on demand. I know it is on some other social media platforms as well. Are you looking to bring this to a New York Film Festival? Because New York right now, I'm telling a lot of people, the film festival circuit right now is popping. And everybody's aching to get back into these things. I would love to see it in Tribeca or one of the other big festivals right now, especially here in New York.
I know that would be awesome, is to have a screening of it. Because of course, you know, after you make a movie, you really realize movies are meant to be seen on the big screen.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just a different experience when you sit there and it's surround sound and it's a huge screen. It's you know, it's one of the sort of realities of present day, is that more and more people are seeing things on a smaller screen, and that's better than nothing. But I would love if people could see it on a big screen in New York. I think Brian Long is working on all of that. As you said, we submitted to a lot of festivals last year and did well, but it would be great to have a New York screening.
Yeah, and I think we would love to have you, and hopefully we look forward to meeting you here in New York City. And you were wonderful. And Florencia, thank you for being a guest on FaceTime with Todd Wharton. I can't wait to have you back and talk about the more success of this film and other things you have coming up. And before we go, do you have anything coming up that some of your fans should know about, as well as my fans, on what could we see more of Florencia Lozano?
I actually do. I have a Netflix series coming out. I'm not sure when it's going to come out. I've heard sometime this summer, June, July, August. Mm-hmm. The series is called Keep Breathing.
Okay.
And Melissa Barrera is on it. She was in West Side Story. No, she was in The Heights.
Yeah.
In The Heights. And in the latest Scream movie, she's wonderful.
Yeah.
Jeff Vielbush is in it, who was in Unorthodox.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an anthology series. And so season one is self-contained. We shot it in Vancouver last summer. And it's basically survival stories.
Yeah.
So a woman crashes in a helicopter in the middle of the Alaskan wilderness. She needs to learn how to survive, build a fire, find shelter. And in order to find the endurance, the will to live, she has to go back and confront the demons from her past. So she has these flashback episodes. And it's a really interesting series, if I do say so myself. It's kind of cool.
I love it. And I'm definitely going to become a fan, because when I saw Ozark, which is kind of a weary type of season, I'm like, wow, I'm listening to you now. I'm like, this might be right up my alley, because I love shows like that. So I think we're going to look forward to seeing that. And again, I recommend everybody go see this film, Life After You. It's a great film, and I definitely recommend it. And definitely check this lady out. And Florencia, thanks for being a guest, and I appreciate you for being here today.
Thank you so much, Todd.
You're welcome.
And I hope to meet you too someday. And
we definitely will. We definitely Yeah, we definitely will meet, I promise you.
Yes. And maybe Gary Perez will be there too, which would be awesome.
Yeah, let's go get a drink and we'll just talk to you about it. Because before we go, if you guys don't know, it's an NYU graduate in Pitt School of Arts. So I'm just letting you know we got New York in the house right here. So
yes, honey.
We're going to have a good time, but I will definitely see you soon. So, Florencia, thanks for being a guest on FaceTime with Todd Wharton. And congratulations on this major film. I think it's incredible. I think it's a film that hits home. And I know we all have a hard time talking about abuse, especially when it comes to drugs and alcohol. But it's films like these that build awareness, and I think it's going to do pretty well in a lot of the film festivals. So guys, if you don't know, definitely go check out this film. It's on pay-per-view, video on demand, and a lot of other streaming platforms. And until next time, like I always say, guys, if you're not living the passionate life, then whose life are you living? I'll see you soon. Take care.
Hey guys, thank you for watching. So the next time you're in the bathroom scrolling on your phone, why don't you stop on by our YouTube channel and subscribe? It's as easy as 1, 2, man, doesn't that feel good?